Hello and welcome to the first of my World War II online introductory videos. These are designed for those of you who are new to the game and just lets you get to grips with some of the basic concepts. You'll find it's a reasonably complex game with a steep learning curve, so it's worth spending just a little bit of time seeing how it all works so you can minimise the amount of time you spend scratching your head and wondering what on earth is going on. So by now, you'll have downloaded the game, activated your free trial account, and be ready to start winning the war. But before you can go around dropping bombs on things, making empty cases at the bad guys, and making tanks go, it's worth just sitting down and learning how the mechanics work. Here's a quick idea of the subjects that we're going to be covering. It's probably best to watch them all in order, but if you don't want to, just feel free to bounce around. Okay, so the first thing we'll see when we load up the game is this welcome screen, and you've got a message of the day and a squad message. Now, just so you know, all new players are automatically assigned to one of the player-run squads that signed up to the game developer's recruit training program. Each of these squads is run by players for players and should be your first port of call for any questions, no matter how small they may be. They'll undertake to teach you the basics of the game, but don't feel like you're trapped there. You can leave the squad at any time to play alone, or join a different squad if that's what you want. It is, though, a really good idea to download and use TeamSpeak 3, which is a free voice chat program. Your new squad is allocated a channel on the game's TeamSpeak servers, and that represents the best way for you to communicate with and learn from your new squad mates. Once you're on that server, you can also jump around into other channels and talk to high commanders, other squads, and just individual players who are all working towards the same objective and hanging around on the same channel. You can even get technical support when the game managers are online. Even if you don't have a microphone, it is worth logging in just to hear what's going on. Of course, you don't have to have TeamSpeak if you don't want to, but I would recommend that you at least give it a try. You'll learn the game much faster, and players who are fighting in the same battle do much better when they can actually talk to guys on their side rather than trying to communicate through text messages. Once you're allocated to your squad, you'll find that some of the squads play solely for one side, while others will switch sides every couple of campaigns. No matter which squad you're assigned to, you will be able to play on both sides for your first 5 days. After that, you can choose to remain with your squad and confine yourself to that side, or if that doesn't appeal to you, you can leave and continue playing for both teams, or find another squad that plays for the faction you want. So, once we clear that screen, the first choice we have to make is which side are we going to fight for, the Axis or the Allies? The first thing we'll notice is if we look next to the German flag up here, it says that they are overpopulated. That just means that they have more guys online right now, whereas the three Allied nations flags all show that they're requesting reinforcements. That means they have fewer players in the game at the moment. Now, sometimes you might see that it says spawn delays are in effect. That means that one side is quite heavily outnumbered. In that case, the side with more players will just have to wait a few seconds before they spawn in, and that's in an effort to try and even up the number of troops on the battlefield. If you want to avoid spawn delay, the thing to do is to join the side that's requesting reinforcements. And playing for both sides once in a while anyway is a good idea, because it gives you a feel for the strengths and weaknesses of the different sides' equipment. Now, some of you may be worried that the Germans are constantly going to be outnumbered because they've got to fight against three of the nations. Well, there's no need to worry about that, because both sides, the Axis and the Allies, have exactly the same number of divisions and brigades. It's just that the Allied armies are split between three different nations. Of course, that means that there's going to be some differences in kit and equipment between the Allied armies, and that means that there's a bit of variety about what they can bring to the battlefield. And sometimes that's a good thing, and sometimes it's not so good. Now, having said that, you might find that sometimes you log in and the Americans are all greyed out and it just says inactive, which will look something like this. But don't worry, that's just a product of the tier system. Essentially, each campaign in World War II Online starts in May of 1940, which is when Germany began the invasion of France and the Low Countries. There are no Americans in the game at this stage because there were no Americans in the war. They were off doing other things. Of course, there is an upside to this. you'll get to play with some funky early war tanks that you're not going to see in the movies. The equipment lists at the start of the campaign are referred to as Tier 0. And then after a couple of weeks, or real time, you'll move up to Tier 1. And this is roughly equivalent to the sort of equipment that you might have seen kicking around in 1941. And then you move up to Tier 2, and so on. So, as the game ticks along, you'll start to see some more familiar stuff. But the important thing for you guys is that Tier 2 is when the Americans show up, and they bring all kinds of cool gear with them, like bazookas and semi-automatic rifles. So for now, we'll just select the French army and get started by clicking on the Select Brigade button. Now, the first screen we're presented with shows the French order of battle on the left and a little map on the right. But we'll ignore this for a second. Go ahead and just click on the Theatre Map tab, which is up here on the top left. The theatre map is pretty straightforward. You can zoom in and out and see different levels of detail using the scroll wheel on your mouse, and you can also click and drag just to pan the map around. Up here is the Zeelands area, and this is where people who like to sail big destroyers hang around. And as we pan the map over to the west, we'll see the southeast coast of England, the northern coast of France, and then back up to the Low Countries, and over towards the Franco-German border. And the map continues eastwards into the German industrial heartland around cities like Essen. Over to the left of the map, you'll see there's a few buttons, and if you briefly hover the mouse over them, you'll see they've got tooltips, which give you an idea of what they do. And we'll go over a few of them now. The one at the bottom toggles the map into full screen mode. The button above that will center the map on you, but that's only actually going to do anything if you've already selected a unit and you've spawned into the game world, which we'll cover later. And above that, we have the radar button, which again, we'll cover it later, but basically it just gives you a rough idea of where enemy aircraft are. Then we have the mission creation button, which will be looked at another time, but above that is the key. It should be fairly obvious what this button does. It gives you an explanation of all the symbols that you might see on the map, just to stop you getting confused. Here we can mess around with the map filters, turn things on and off, and just get the map set up the way we like it. And then the next one is actually quite useful. If we select a set town, you just click on any town, and then use this button. It gives you a list of all the buildings, all the capturable buildings within the town, and who owns them. And it also tells you all the units that are stationed in the town, which is quite useful. Next up, we have a means of locating a town on the map. You just click on the city finder and then start typing in the name of the town. As you go, suggestions will pop up below, and then you click on the one you want and it will select that town and shift the map over to it for you. And then finally, you've got the information button. Some of this won't make any sense at the moment. You've got what brigade you're part of, origin and target, which clearly is only going to be relevant once you've joined a mission and you're actually spawned into the game world. Beneath that, the latitude and longitude would tell you exactly where you were if you were actually spawned in, but also it will tell you the latitude and longitude of where your mouse pointer is. And that's actually quite useful if you're using, say, the light mortar. It's possible to use latitude and longitude to work out precise distances between two locations, so you can have an idea of what range to plug into your mortar. And there are people out there in the community who've made online tools which allow you to work out precise distances between two points just using your latitude and longitude figures. And yep, it is possible to kill yourself with your own mortar bombs if you set them to minimum range, and it looks a little something like this. And mortars are also useful for dropping smoke, which has this pleasing white fluffy appearance. And now we'll take a look at how things are represented on the theatre map, and it's pretty straightforward. You've got your open areas, your wooded and forested areas, the big blue lines pretty clearly represent rivers, and the bridge symbols next to them are the bridges over them. Your towns are all represented by little faction mini-flags, along with the name of the town or city next to it. You can see that each of the towns are linked to each other by little white and red lines, which represent roads, and these are quite good for driving on. They let you get a little bit faster, and they look something like this. Whilst your black lines represent railways, and they're not as easy to drive on. You tend to bounce around quite a lot, and they look like this. And sadly, you can't drive trains, and neither can you be the fat controller. If we get a little bit closer to this town, you can see that little anchor symbol, and that just means that the town has got a dock and access to the river. Naval brigades can be placed here, and you can also spawn Fairmile patrol boats. Now if we find a town that's out on deeper water, we'll see this symbol. This represents a deep water port, and it can be used to spawn bigger ships, like freighters and destroyers. This little aircraft symbol means that you have an airfield, so you can spawn fighters, bombers and transport planes if there is an Air Force brigade located here. And you'll just see as I hover my mouse over this bridge symbol below, it gives me the name of the bridge. So now as we move the map back over towards the front lines, you'll probably have noticed that not all towns look the same. Some of them are just represented by the small faction mini symbol, whilst others have a bigger flag flying above them and a couple of dots off to the side of that flag. Ownership of the town is denoted by the faction mini symbol, but if there's no flag flying above it, then it means that there are no brigades stationed there. If you hover your mouse over it, it'll tell you who controls the town, but nothing more. Of course, this doesn't mean that you won't find any troops there. It's perfectly possible to drive vehicles and infantry from neighbouring towns, or even to drop paratroopers. But you'll find that even if nobody does that, each town is guarded by a small number of computer-controlled machine gun posts and light anti-tank guns, and they look a little bit like this. These guys are set up to fire just within fixed arcs, so basically any enemy that moves within their arcs and is in range, they'll start shooting at. The anti-tank guns, to be honest, are pretty inaccurate, and you'd be very unlucky to ever get killed by one, whereas the machine gun nests tend to be quite accurate and can be a real pain for attacking troops. Now, fortunately, these can be destroyed by grenades, satchel charges, bombs, cannon fire, and even machine guns if you can get enough rounds on target. So if we see a flag flying above a town's name, that means that you've got brigades stationed there. And if you hover your mouse over it, then it'll give you the name of those brigades. The number of dots off to the left-hand side of the flag tells you the number of brigades there. For army units, each division has 4 brigades. It's a headquarters, 2 infantry, and 1 armoured. The armoured brigade obviously has quite a lot of tanks, but not too many infantry, whereas the infantry brigades are the other way around. A headquarters brigade has a smattering of everything, and it tends to get used in last-ditch defences or to plug gaps. Now if we go here and select a town that has a headquarters brigade in it, you'll see the little blue lines that link it to its daughter brigades. That is the armoured and 2 infantry brigades that together with that headquarters form a division. Well, that just about wraps up the theatre map and video 1. In the next video, we'll talk about winning the game and the supply system, and brush on attack and defence orders. Thanks for watching.